lessons do you think the American foreign policy establishment has taken from the Iraq war?
Well, I mean, I think there is a consensus in Washington that the Iraq war was a mistake. I mean, that's a realization across the board that it was a disaster for U.S. foreign policy. It accelerated American decline. It increased anti-American sentiment. It was a recruiting tool for al-Qaeda. So I think we realize that now. But unfortunately, what lesson do you learn from that going forward? Because Iraq was a very particular case. So I think you have some people who want to say that Libya is like Iraq and we shouldn't have gone in because it's a war of choice and it's going to be a quagmire. But Libya was a totally different situation where Libyans themselves were calling for the U.S. to get involved. So it's really unclear how to take the lessons of Iraq and apply them in entirely different situations. But I think more broadly speaking, there is a disillusion with the Bush administration's kind of cowboy diplomacy, this kind of aggressive militaristic approach. There's now more of an emphasis on soft power, on building consensus. And we saw that process in Libya with the Obama administration's approach. Whether or not that is more effective, I think we'll still have to wait and see.
You recently said that it's possible to overlearn those lessons. What did you mean by that? And when you talk about the NATO intervention in Libya, on some level, whether or not it's a good intervention or bad intervention, you know, can you tell me where that can sort of place the Americans? And is it history repeating itself if we look at the Mujahideen and America's response to assisting them in the 80s? And then from that came Osama bin Laden. You know, could this be a situation where it's a good intervention that could turn sour?
Well, I mean, yeah, so I would say, first and foremost, this was a good intervention because the U.S. aligned itself with Arab democratic aspirations, and Libya is one of the only places in the world where people actually seem to like Obama and they're slaughtering sheep in honor of Sarkozy and things like that. So that's good. Now, the question is, how do you facilitate the reconstruction of a shattered country? And that, I think, is a big challenge now, which is why the international community has to stay involved so we don't see a repeat of Afghanistan, where once the Soviets were out, we said, we're going to wash our hands of Afghanistan and we're going to leave them to do their own thing. And then we have the emergence of civil conflict and civil war. So the lesson there to learn is, I don't want to call it nation building per se, but we have to help the Libyans rebuild their nation. And that's not just a U.S. thing. The U.S., the EU, Turkey, Qatar, everyone that has a stake in the future of the Libyan people has to play a role.
So when you do say it's easy to, you know, overlearn those lessons, is that what you mean, that there shouldn't be a comparison to Iraq because it's a different situation in Libya, even though we shouldn't really abandon them now that we've sort of been a silent partner in this intervention?
Okay, I think the way to look at it is that there are interventions and there are bad interventions and good interventions. The lesson we should learn from Iraq is avoid bad interventions. That doesn't mean that we should, you know, paint a broad brush and say any kind of intervention in an Arab country is by definition bad. And all the circumstances were quite different in Libya. Libyans themselves were calling for us as Americans to intervene and to play that kind of role. The Arab League came out in support of the Libya intervention. That was not present in the Iraqi case. And this was fundamentally a humanitarian intervention. Gaddafi's forces were marching towards Benghazi. If the world didn't act, there was going to be a massacre. And personally, I don't feel comfortable with the idea of staying silent while people are being massacred in broad daylight. And we have the ability to stop it. There is a responsibility to protect. And that's a UN-sponsored norm now. There's broad support for that idea. And we should live up to that, I think.
There were double standards when we have the capacity to intervene in Syria or Bahrain or Yemen, and then we choose not to.
There's a total double standard when it comes to U.S. policy in the region. There's always going to be that level of hypocrisy because the U.S. has principles, but we also have interests, and the interests and the principles don't always converge. Oftentimes, they're actually in conflict with each other. So in a place like Bahrain, where we have certain kind of military and security interests, we're going to be less willing to put pressure on the Bahraini regime to democratize. Syria is also a very difficult question as well, and it's remarkable to me that it took 5 months for the U.S. to call for Assad to go, and more than 2,000 people killed. And I think that goes to show that, generally speaking, if we want to look at U.S. policy during the Arab Spring, the Obama administration has been behind the curve in nearly every single country. I think over time, you know, that's going to lead to hurting America's credibility. People aren't going to trust us or look to us to play a constructive role, because even when we do the right thing, we wait until the very last moment to do it.
You know, the neocons would have argued and continue to argue that invading Iraq and attempting to bring democracy to that country planted the seeds of the Arab Spring. Would you agree?
I mean, drawing a link between the Iraq invasion and the current Arab Spring is absolute nonsense. I mean, you would have to show some kind of causal link. I mean, how do we get from point A to point B? If anything, Iraq soured millions of Arabs on the very idea of democracy promotion. I mean, the U.S. gave democracy promotion a bad name because of the Bush administration's policies. And I think Iraq became a model of not what to do, but what not to do, where people were saying sectarianism, civil war, instability. Democracy is great, but do we want what Iraq has? So I think it actually pushed the Arab Spring back and perhaps even delayed it, actually.
And is this perhaps not about, you know, a political thought, but it's about young people and this socioeconomic issue developed over a period of time that's caused the Arab Spring?
I mean, socioeconomic issues are key, and that's also closely connected to the political side as well. I don't think we should separate the issues too much. But yes, I mean, it's no accident that the first two Arab revolutions were Tunisia and Egypt. They were actually the two countries that had the best economic growth, and the World Bank and the IMF were giving them accolades for, you know, the best place to do business in the Middle East and all of that. Egypt saw 5-7% annual GDP growth for the last 7 years. So, but economic growth without redistribution can be dangerous. So you had the rich getting richer and the poor getting poorer, but the poor were watching the rich and saying, how come we aren't getting that? We want a piece of the pie too. So I think that's a major part of the story here, in trying to understand what led to such anger and frustration among young Arabs.
Now that, you know, it seems that the Gaddafi regime has fallen, would you say the Arab Spring is over? Or do you foresee that other nations will follow, and perhaps Assad will go and some of the others?
The Arab Spring is going to be a long process, and I think we have to have some patience and have a longer-term perspective. So now we have Egypt, Tunisia, and Libya have all had their revolutions, right? But there are other countries that are on the brink. Syria is on the brink. Yemen is on the brink. And the psychological barrier of fear has been broken. Arabs are no longer afraid to go out into the streets and protest and demand their rights and even die for their rights and freedoms. So that is the precedent that the Arab Spring has set. And I think that means a totally new Arab world from here on out. We can't go to the way things were before, you know, in December 2010, before Tunisia. We'll never be able to return to that.
And what will it mean? To bring in different voices, will it make the region more stable? And what will it mean for the West? What kind of security will that pose? Will there be less security threats, more security threats, especially with the uprising of groups like the Muslim Brotherhood?
Well, the Arab Spring means short-term instability. Democratic transitions, even in the best of circumstances, are messy, uncertain, and occasionally bloody. That's just the way it's going to be. But what I would argue is that short-term instability will eventually lead into long-term stability. That sometimes that's a necessary evil to get from point A to point B. But I think more generally, U.S. interests are maybe undermined in some cases, because what does democracy mean? Democracy means that governments have to be responsive to their people. And it happens to be the case that their people are quite anti-American. They're angry at the U.S. for its policies in the region. So we're going to probably see governments that have a more anti-American feel to them, that are more nationalistic, and especially with the rise of groups like the Muslim Brotherhood. I mean, that's worlds apart from what you had with Mubarak, who was a reliable U.S. ally. He didn't do everything America wanted, but he did a lot of it. All bets are off now. I mean, you can't rely on that anymore. And that's why I think the relationship with the Arab world is going to have to be rebuilt according to mutual respect and mutual understanding, where both sides give and take and both sides have something to offer. It's not going to be this one-way relationship the way it was in previous decades.
Which leads me to my next question. What do you think the West, and especially the United States, can do to ensure that their transition into becoming more democratic states and functioning in a democratic way is easier for these states?
Well, the U.S. has an important role to play after these revolutions because, I mean, the stabilization process is oftentimes the most challenging. So the U.S. can play a role in terms of funding. And not just the U.S., but in coordination with its European allies, with its Arab allies, to make sure that these emerging governments have the money they need to rebuild their countries, but also technical assistance. I mean, how do you hold a free and fair election when you haven't done that for 6 decades? So I think there is a role to play here. But I think the countries that haven't had their revolutions yet, the U.S. needs to put pressure on autocratic Arab regimes to open up and to democratize, because my real fear is that the U.S. will be remembered as being on the wrong side of history during this Arab Spring. So we have to pick a side and say, are we with Arab democratic aspirations or are we not?
And just finally, I mean, just out of interest, when we look at the United States' role in bringing and applying democracy into places like Afghanistan or Iraq, and in terms of elections that have been held, you know, they were deeply flawed, the way that the ballot was conducted. Do you think that really there is any role for the Americans to play? I mean, when we see examples of the way that they assist these other nations in conducting their elections, can that then be translated to the Arab world, or should we just write off Afghanistan and Iraq as two big mistakes, and let's try and work with these nations that are more developed in terms of, you know, more established or have better civil institutions?
In looking at Afghanistan and Iraq, they were mistakes, but I don't think they should be representative of U.S. policy overall. And just because the U.S. has failed in the past doesn't mean it's doomed to fail in the future. And I think now is the time to try to do the right thing. The U.S. does, it's true. I mean, the U.S. has a tragic history in the Middle East. We've messed up time and time again. We've supported dictatorships for more than 5 decades, remarkably consistently. But on the other hand, we do have a better record in places like Eastern Europe, in Latin America, at least after supporting some autocratic regimes. So I think there is precedent for the U.S. to facilitate democratic transitions. I mean, to play a good role in places like Ukraine, in Georgia, during the colored revolutions. So there is a kind of expertise and knowledge based on America's own democratic experience as well. But I think what's more important than the U.S. playing that role on its own is to bring together different countries with different experiences, perhaps developing countries like Indonesia, like Brazil, that recently came out of their own autocratic experiences and have gone through a fairly successful transition to democracy. Egyptians have a lot to learn from those models, and the U.S. can be a convening power in bringing these different groups together to talk about what is the best way to go forward.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, sure, my pleasure.